Hello and welcome to One North Maine. I'm Jay Miller, and today we're focused on the one, the only, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. There were three special events in our fair city that celebrated the life and times of a great leader. First, we were over at the 31st annual NAACP Martin Luther King Breakfast. Next, we traveled to Messiah Baptist Church, where Temple Beth Amuna and the church collaborated on yet another fantastic event. And then finally, we were at the Cape Verdean Association, where on Martin Luther King Day, the CVA put together an event that featured kids and some moving words. So sit back and relax and see what your community, the City of Champions, has to offer. NAACP of the Brockton area is on fire. They held their 31st annual Martin Luther King Breakfast. There were dignitaries that spoke. We had a change in leadership, and some kids were recognized for their great effort. The master of ceremonies was none other than Bishop Tony Branch. Bishop, get us fired up.
Freedom fighters in this house tonight. Is there someone in this place that believes in equality? Can you say yes? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm gonna go black church. If you believe equality, can you say amen? Yes. Is there someone in this place today that believes in justice? Can you say amen? Yes. Is there someone in this place today that believes in civil rights? Can you say amen? Yes. Now give yourself a hand clap if you can.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song.
Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us.
Joyce and Steve, on behalf of the Brockton branch of the NAACP, we want to say thank you for all your work. And we're giving you the Nam Ellis Award for Outstanding Leadership. And again, we wish you, as you step down from your daily tasks at the NAACP, you continue to work with us and you continue to be on our committees. And so we give you this token of our appreciation, and we want to say that thank you and thank Joyce for her sacrifice and allowing us to have you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all so much. Thank you all so much. Before becoming president in 1991, just before becoming president, before the election, I was invited by the Rotary Club to speak before them and to speak words of the NAACP, and I accepted the award. And I went to the luncheon on Thursday afternoon, and much to my surprise, Nan Ellison was there before me. And she met me at the door and said, "Steve, as long as I'm the president, I speak on behalf of the NAACP." And I'm reminded of that as I leave this position, I'm not going to speak about the past, and I'm certainly not going to be talking about what's going to happen in the future, because what? I'm no longer the president. Nan did allow me to introduce her on that day, and that was an honor. And so it is my great pleasure to introduce to you the new president of the Brockton branch of the NAACP, Mr. William Brewer, who will now and henceforth be the presiding officer and the man from whom the word will come. Let's not fear change. Let's not fear change, but let's be embracing change and embracing our right to make certain that change will come. Even the new things that we're facing, we can change as American citizens. I'm so proud to have been your leader of this organization for many years, 1991 to 1999, and again, 2012 to 2016. But it has been my life, as you know. Harry O. Bernard led the charge here in 1953 to have a branch opened here in Brockton, as he was a member of the Boston branch in his early lives before he moved here in 1923. And as his grandson, and as the son of Norman and Verena Bernard, who are active in the NAACP, and many of you in this room, particularly in this far corner, Messiah Baptist Church, Lincoln Congregational Church, remember my dear mother and father. I'm proud to love you all and to be remembered. To remember them, to thank you, and to encourage our new leader, William, to take us forth. And lastly, I want to say thanks to my wife and family.
Everyone should be able to celebrate and worship in the faith that they choose. And we should remember that Dr. King was very, very vigilant in the idea that we must speak truth to power. He said that the day we begin to die is the day that we remain silent in the face of oppression.
We come together this morning to say that we are our brother's keeper.
Yes, yes.
And we have a responsibility to speak up when there is injustice. Dr. King sought change through nonviolence, and he appealed to the fairness of America when he asked America to live up to its creed, to live up to the Constitution. Dr. King was an activist. He was an activist when he led the Montgomery bus boycott. He was an activist when he led the March on Washington. He was an activist when he went to Cairo and marched. And yes, he was an activist when he went to Memphis and he paid the ultimate price. We must be activists. We must engage our public institutions. We must seek justice when there is injustice.
Dr. King said, "People fail to get along because they don't know each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. They don't know each other because they have not communicated with each other." And I think it's our opportunity as a city to take a leadership role and to be a true 21st century city. I mean, there's no more diverse city than the city of Brockton.
So when you leave this place today and when you say bad kids, I want you to look at my children here, because they're my babies too, and remember the faces of the children at this 31st breakfast. And remember, we got the best, we got the cream of the crop in our community. Now give them a hand clap.
When Dr. King awoke each day to that gentle battle, if he had slept at all, he chose to march in the direction of peace, in the direction of love. And I know each of you, elected officials, NAACP members, and community activists, you choose to march in that direction every day. It didn't just happen, you decided. You strive daily through your advocacy and policies and lobbying efforts to see Dr. King's beloved community realized and to see his unfinished work advanced. Every day, in the midst of your own gentle battle, regardless of who's in the White House, you make the decision to march in this direction.
There are few people throughout history that could bring together a Baptist church in a Jewish temple. Dr. King did locally here in Brockton. Temple Beth Emunah again partnered up with the Messiah Baptist Church located in downtown Brockton and put together a fantastic event featuring the chief of police from the Middleton Police Department. It was quite a show, quite an event. Let's take a look.
I would like to start today's program with a quote from Dr. King. On June 2nd, 1959, King delivered the commencement address at Morehouse College. During that commencement speech, he said, "We must be concerned about every human being." My name is Steve Weiner from Temple Beth Emunah, and it's my honor to be standing here beside Sharon Mulden from Messiah Baptist Church. Like I said last year, Messiah is so fortunate to have such a jewel in Sharon. The way that our two churches work together is what Dr. King saw the night before he died when he looked over the mountaintop.
We're the children of Nimrod. We shall not live by Ham alone. We're Nimrod's children, and we gladly and happily embrace the legacy of Nimrod and of Vashti. And in the spirit of Nimrod, in the spirit of Vashti, we celebrate this day. We recognize at the same time, as the rabbi just said, we're not out of the wilderness yet. We're not out of the wilderness. When we witness a president, a president-elect, the first meeting in the black community happens to be with a rapper, a comedian, and a football player. That says we're not out of the wilderness yet.
It is fitting that the day upon which we honor and remember Martin Luther King Jr. occurs in the week within which the Jewish community begins the reading of the book of Exodus. In so many of his speeches, King referenced the Israelite struggle to become free. Moses' anguished and powerful cry of "Let my people go," and the actual exodus from Egypt as a parallel narrative to the experience of African Americans. As people of faith, we intrinsically understand that regardless of color, socioeconomic status, gender, sexual orientation, or religious identification, we are all God's people.
Thanks to both the temple and to the church for again hosting this wonderful program that's found its new home here at Messiah. People fail to get along because they don't know each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. They don't know each other because they have not communicated with each other. And when I think about the state of our country and the state of our city today, thinking about the fear and the different types of fear that we're faced with today. Today, I would like to announce the reinstatement of the Citizens Police Academy, which has been dormant for about 10 years now, maybe even a little longer than 10 years. And I think that as part of our growing commitment and expansion of community policing, this is another aspect of community policing, that this academy will run for residents who are interested to participate in one night a week for 6 or 8 weeks. but designed to give the community a clearer understanding of police work and a clearer understanding of the challenges and the issues that are faced by the police department. But it's also to continue that communication, bridge that gap so that both the police can have a better understanding of what the community is thinking and the community can have greater insight to the police.
I tell you this to give you a little backdrop of why so many Jews are involved in the civil rights movement. And one in particular I'd like to talk a little bit about is Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel. He's considered to be one of the great theologians in the 20th century. However, it was his experience during the Holocaust and a study of Jewish prophets that influenced his belief that Judaism required a life filled with both deeds and actions. Rabbi Heschel was an outspoken activist for civil rights who marched with Dr. King, met with John F. Kennedy about civil rights legislation, and is celebrated by many in the Jewish community for his involvement in the civil rights movement and other movements for social justice. His reflection on participating on the civil rights movement, this Rabbi Gauss didn't I talk about this. Thank you for letting me have this one. Anytime, you're so gracious. In the civil rights movement from Selma, from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama, in March 1965, I felt like my legs were praying. Has become a model of activism in religious practice. He literally walked arm in arm with Dr. King.
It is a pleasure to be here with you, Reverend Walker, Rabbi Gauss. Point of privilege, I just want to thank the mayor, who I see today, and our elected officials. I want to acknowledge the members of the temple, as well as the congregation of Messiah Baptist Church. So thank you. Racial profiling is a practice by law enforcement officials to target individuals for suspicions of a crime based on their individual race, ethnicity, religion, national origin. Racial profiling is a long-standing and deeply troubling problem for America. People are sworn to protect and serve cannot racial profile. The fact of the matter is, as a young man growing up, we saw the police as someone to view us. They watched us. Other communities saw them as being their protectors. Racial profile has led to people to live in fear, to castigate entire communities, simply because of where they lived and where they are. We look forward to dealing with our racial profile in the city of Brockton.
A little bit about myself. Not only am I the chief of Middleton Police Department and the president of the Massachusetts Police Chiefs Association, I'm also, and I have been for the past 10 years, the executive director of the Law Enforcement Torch Run for Special Olympics. Today, we rightfully remember Dr. King and how he gave a voice to the silent hopes of millions of Americans. Over five decades have passed since Dr. King's voice cut through the silence. But his words still ring true, possessing a power and an influence unmatched in our times. His teaching showed that violence, segregation, and indecency had already afflicted our nation far too long, and that only the way to heal the wounds of the past and bound onward into the future was by loving and respecting one another.
The Cape Verdean Association held their second annual Martin Luther King Day celebration honoring the King of Dreamers. It was fantastic, and let me tell you why. The kids were into it. Let's take a look.
Welcome, everybody, to our second annual Martin Luther King Day celebration.
And on behalf of the Cape Verdean Association, I just want to thank everyone for participating in today's event and for being here so we can hear a little bit about Martin Luther King and all the great words.
In the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. If there's friends in this house, say, I'm a friend.
I'm a friend.
Yeah, no, y'all just too quiet. If there's friends in this house, say that I'm a friend.
I'm a friend.
If you're a friend of equality, say that I'm a friend.
I'm a friend.
If you're a friend of justice, say that I'm a friend.
I'm a friend.
If you believe in the fight for civil rights, say I'm a friend.
I'm a friend.
Sounds about right.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall
made up by the loving care of my mother Alberta and my grandmother Jenny. My dad could be strict, but I knew it was tough love. I remember when I would listen closely to his sermons every Sunday. I'm gonna be just like him one day when I grow up. I would think to myself as the congregation burst into hallelujahs and praise. Times weren't always that great though. And even though everything mom, pop, and grandma did for me, I wasn't always my best listening to them. How could I expect that to happen though? I wanted to go to a parade like everyone else in my school, like every other 12-year-old my age. Who would think something could happen to my grandmother while I was gone? It must have been all my fault. If I was there when it happened, I could have done something to save her. But where was I, goofing off at some stupid parade? How can I ever hope to be great like Dad if I can't even be there for those who matter most to me when they really need me?
I knew I had big shoes to fill. I wasn't gonna let that stop me from becoming great. Grandma Jenny always said that if I did my best in school, something important in the world, then I wouldn't be treated so bad. So I studied. study longer and harder than I ever studied before. I'm going to be the best student that Booker T. Washington High ever has ever seen. I even skipped 10th and 12th grade and started college at 15. That shows how hard I studied. And boy, did it pay off. Everyone loved me, especially the ladies. School was great and all, but college life was amazing. I barely could focus on most of my classes. And being away from home, I really started thinking about my family and my life. My family was always talking about religion. God, religion and God. Lord this, Lord Almighty that. Everyone in church was screaming and yelling, singing at the top of their voice. But where was God? Does he not see the good in people? Does he not see good people like my family and so many others are going through? Or maybe he just doesn't care. I don't know. I want to be my dad up on the altar. Nowadays, I just don't know anymore.
I can't believe I met a woman like her. I mean, she's staying as she dances, she's beautiful, and she's everything I ever wished for. It's funny how things play out in life. I remember back in college, I wasn't even thinking of doing ministry work. That Bible class I took junior year changed everything, quite possibly my whole life. If it wasn't for that, my faith would have never been restored, and I would have never ended up at Crozer Seminary, Pennsylvania, where I graduated valedictorian and student body president, by the way. Many nights I spent playing pool, having cool beers, even though I knew Dad wouldn't approve. It was then I met Mr. Mayer's Morehouse College president. He was a strong man. He opened my eyes to what all the injustice people are going through and how God was going to help us fix it. It was then I knew I had to be the change I wanted to see. I was going to let God do his work through me. I decided to pursue a PhD. I could have gone to Yale, I could have gone to Scotland, but I chose Boston University. Only God knew this is where I would find the woman I would fall in love with for the rest of my life. Now we've been married, have four beautiful kids, and nothing could be better. I'm 25 years old and I got a doctorate. Truly blessed.
It's December 1st, 1955. Now is our chance. We've waited for this moment for so long. Last week, a brave woman was on a bus and took her stand for justice by not giving her seat up to another simply because she was asked to. And they had the nerve to try her in court, find her guilty, and fine her. This cannot go on. Last night, myself, the head of our local NAACP chapter, E.D. Nixon, and many other community leaders came to a conclusion. We must boycott the buses in Montgomery. We have been silent, we have been patient, now we must act. Show this country we will not tolerate the injustices any longer. But the committee asked me to lead this. Me? I'm barely 20 years old and I'm not even from around here. How could I lead this? Martin, you're young, well-trained, with solid family connections and professional standing. Yeah, right, there's hundreds of people with those qualities, better suited to lead. Wait a minute. What am I saying? All those late nights talking with Mr. Mays back in Crozer Seminary about the change we could through the Lord if we let his hands work through us, and now the Lord is willing to use me and I think of saying no? No, I expect your will, Lord, because we will have no alternative but to protest. For many years, we have shown an amazing patience. We have sometimes given our white brothers the feeling that we like the way that we're being treated. But we come here tonight to be safe from that patience that makes us patient with anything less than freedom and justice.
And let me tell you, when you're talking about civil rights, when you're remembering Dr. King, we don't want to just remember him. We want to emulate Dr. King. Does anybody know what that means? To emulate somebody. It's not just to mimic, but it's to model yourselves.
There you have it, Brockton. Another One North Maine in the books. Thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed this episode as much as we enjoyed covering those three classic Dr. Martin Luther King Day events. To learn more about Brockton Community Access, please visit our website at bcatv.org. You can also check out our YouTube page, youtube.com/TheBrocktonChannel, all one word. For everyone at One North Maine, I'm Jay Miller, and we will see you around town.
Ha 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 ha.